performing spirometry, there are two main defects that we can have, which are called ventilatory defects. One is obstructive and the other is restrictive. Now, a restrictive ventilatory defect essentially just means that the lungs are reduced in their volume. So when we do spirometry, we measure the total amount of air that can be expired, and we measure that as the forced vital capacity, the FVC. If the FVC is reduced, then this is consistent with a restrictive ventilatory defect, because the FVC gives us a bit of an idea as to the lung volume. We have to remember that when we expire as much air as possible out of our lungs, there still is air in the lungs. That's called our residual volume. That's the volume of air that we actually can't get out. And there needs to be some residual volume, because otherwise the lung would collapse. So the residual volume is the amount of air that's left in the lung after we expire as much as possible. So our forced vital capacity isn't a true measure of lung volume, but it gives us a bit of an idea as to lung volume. So if the forced vital capacity is reduced, then there are really two possibilities. Either the lung volume is truly reduced, and this is what we call a restrictive ventilatory defect. But the other possibility is that there could be gas trapping. And gas trapping is as it sounds. So if you expire and are not able to get any more air out of the lungs, but there's gas trapping, such as in a situation where the airways are floppy, like in COPD, and the airways have all shut or closed, but there's still a lot of air within the air in the lungs, then this is called gas trapping. So the forced vital capacity could potentially be falsely reduced in the setting of gas trapping. Often we can realise that clinically. So if you know that the patient has COPD, sometimes when they've got gas trapping, you can tell because they've got a barrel chest. If you've got an X-ray, sometimes they've got hyperexpansion on the X-ray. And so sometimes it's obvious that there's gas trapping. If it's not obvious, we can then do more complicated tests in the respiratory lab to measure total lung volume. And that measures your forced vital capacity and your residual volume, so it gives you a more accurate lung volume. However, most of the time, if forced vital capacity is reduced, we can assume that there is a restrictive ventilatory defect. More common is an obstructive ventilatory defect. An obstructive ventilatory defect means that there's airflow obstruction to expiration. So as we are forcefully expiring the air from our lungs, something is causing a reduction to flow. So something is slowing down the speed by which we can expire or force the air out. So that might be due to narrowing of the airways, such as in asthma or COPD. Sometimes it can be due to mucus within the airways, or sometimes if the airways become floppy, they can reduce that expiratory flow rate. So when we do that forceful expiratory maneuver, we also measure the volume of air that we can expire in that first second, and that is the forced expiratory volume in 1 second, or the FEV1. Now, we should be able to expire 70% of the total amount of air that we can get out of our lung in 1 second. So that means all of the air within the lung that we are able to get out, we get 70% out in the first second, and then the rest, the leftover 30%, takes another 5 or 6 seconds to expire. So obviously the rate by which we can expire becomes fast very quickly and then tapers off. If we're not able to expire 70% of our forced vital capacity within that first second, then that means there's airflow obstruction, because there's something slowing down the expiratory flow rate, something is making it harder to get the air out. So if we get 65 or 60% of our lung volume out in that first second, then that means there's airflow obstruction. So when we look at the spirometry values, we look at the FEV1 to FVC ratio. If that's 70% or above, there's no airflow obstruction. If it's below 70%, there is airflow obstruction. Sometimes that ratio is found on the spirometry result as the FER, and that stands for the forced expiratory ratio, which essentially is interchangeable and means the same thing. So purely based on those two measurements, the FEV1, the forced vital capacity, and the ratio of those two numbers, we're able to tell whether the patient has airflow obstruction, has airflow restriction, or has normal spirometry. So then we repeat the spirometry after having administered the bronchodilator. Now, a significant bronchodilator response means that either the FEV1 or the FVC improves by both 12% and 200 mils. So the improvement has to be both 12% and 200 mils, but the improvement can be in either the FEV1 or the FVC. The reason it has to be 12% and 200 mils is because if a patient has poor lung function to begin with, and say their FEV1 is only 1 litre, a 12% improvement is only 120 mils. So that doesn't reach significance. On the other end of the scale, if someone's FEV1 is 2 litres and it improves by 200 mils, then that's only 10% and still does not reach significance. So the improvement has to be both 12% and 200 mils. However, the situation is different in children because children's lung volumes are smaller to begin with. Their improvement only needs to be 12% and the absolute volume is not necessary. One thing I always found difficult to understand is, what does a significant bronchodilator response mean? If a patient has a significant bronchodilator response, should they be treated with bronchodilators? If a patient does not have a significant bronchodilator response, should they not be treated with bronchodilators? And it's really important to realise that that is not the case, that a significant bronchodilator response is telling us that the patient has an asthma-like phenotype. So if someone has a significant bronchodilator response, it tends to suggest that there may be underlying asthma. It doesn't necessarily mean that they do have asthma, because the diagnosis is a clinical diagnosis, but if the clinical situation is consistent with asthma, so say a young person who is a non-smoker with cough or wheeze, then that is certainly diagnostic of asthma. But the treatment for asthma is inhaled corticosteroids. By definition, patients with COPD do not have a significant bronchodilator response. But the treatment for COPD is bronchodilators. And that's something that I always found difficult to understand. And the reason for that is that when we talk about a significant bronchodilator response, it needs to be that big response. So we're looking for a big response, and it tells us that there's airway inflammation that is responding in a large way to the bronchodilator. It's not telling us that that's what we should treat the patient with. So that's important to remember. If there's a significant bronchodilator response, we're thinking that there might be an asthma-like phenotype suggestive of airway inflammation, and in patients with asthma, we need to be treating with inhaled corticosteroids. So then why, in a patient with COPD, who by definition does not have a significant bronchodilator response, why are we treating them with bronchodilators? And the reason is that when we give the bronchodilator, even though the response is not significant, there is still some bronchodilation, and that can be clinically beneficial. And one of the main reasons that it's clinically beneficial is that it reduces dynamic hyperinflation. Dynamic hyperinflation is a useful thing to think about, because what happens when there is airflow obstruction is that there is slowing down of expiratory flow, as I explained before. So if expiratory flow rate is slowed down, takes longer to get the air out, that means that there has to be an increase time between each breath. So as you're sitting at rest, like I am now, breathing at 14 or 16 breaths per minute, it's easy. I can breathe in, breathe out, breathe in again, and I'm breathing at tidal volume without breathlessness. If I start to exercise and my metabolic demand increases, my respiratory rate increases, what happens is that there's less time between each breath. And if there's less time between each breath, if I've got airflow obstruction, I might reach a point where there's not enough time to get the air out. So I get the air in, and I start breathing out, but before I get that air that I've breathed in all out, I'm taking my next breath in again. And then I'm breathing out again, and I'm taking my next breath in again. So every breath I take, I'm leaving more air in my chest. And so that's why it's dynamic hyperinflation. The chest is essentially filling up with air. And you can see this sometimes with your patients with COPD. They, on exercise, they start breathing up at higher lung volumes. And then when they rest, their respiratory rate reduces, they slowly allow that air to come out of their chest, they catch their breath again. Now what bronchodilation does is it opens up lots and lots of small airways and it makes that expiratory flow rate quicker, so it makes it easier to get the air out. And so the result of that is a reduction in that dynamic hyperinflation. And that's one of the main reasons why using a bronchodilator is useful symptomatically in people with COPD. So we just have to remember that a significant bronchodilator response is not telling us that we should be treating with a bronchodilator or not treating with a bronchodilator. It's telling us whether it's likely that there might be underlying asthma or not.